All right, so climate change is the existential question that humanity is facing. Just hearing those two words, I can feel my heart rate going up.
Climate change!
Oh, there it goes. But here's my worry. Are we too late? Has climate change reached the point of no return? I guess what I'm trying to ask is, are we doomed? Greta Thunberg became a household name when she sailed to New York City and spoke her mind about climate change directly to the United Nations.
How dare you continue to look away and come here saying that you're doing enough when the politics and solutions needed are still nowhere in sight?
At just 16, Greta has become the face of a youth-led global movement that's dead set on taking action against climate change. I had the chance to talk to some of the people involved in the movement to get their perspective.
How do you guys feel about the current state of climate change? I talk to a lot of people like my age and younger, and everybody seems kind of like anxious. They're like always on 10. So do you guys kind of relate to that?
I definitely do. I really worry about the future. It really concerns me that there's so many kids here that should be in school, but like they have to fight for their future.
It's overbearing, you know? We're all living on this earth. We all need to do something to protect it because damn near no one did before us.
The older generation isn't doing anything, so it's put on us because we're the ones who are gonna have to live in it. So we have to do something so the earth doesn't just explode.
Now I'm no climate expert, so I figured I'd better talk to an actual climate expert. So I took a trip to UC Berkeley to speak with Dr. Daniel Kahneman. He's a professor of energy and was a part of a United Nations climate panel that won the 2007 Nobel Peace Prize. So he knows what he's talking about.
All right, so I guess just jumping right into it, are we doomed?
We're not doomed, but we're doing our best to become doomed. Every little bit of warming we get from now on means more intense hurricanes, more droughts, more fires, more disruption in fish and food systems. And that's the path that we're on.
All right, a quick little climate change recap. Since around 1880, the average global temperature of the Earth has increased by 1 degree Celsius or 1.8 degrees Fahrenheit. That increase is due almost entirely to humans burning fossil fuels, mostly from 1950 on. That might not sound like a big increase, but it is. It means sea level rise, shrinking polar ice caps, and increased extreme weather events like heat waves and monsoons. Now, as bad as all that is, things can get even worse the hotter that the planet gets. That's why 190 plus countries signed onto the Paris Climate Agreement. The goal is to limit the temperature increase to 1.5 degrees Celsius or 2.7 degrees Fahrenheit by the end of this century. Many scientists say that staying under 1.5 puts us near the upper limit of what's tolerable. We'll have droughts, sea level rise, and extreme weather, but chances are we can manage it. But in case you haven't noticed, we haven't stopped burning fossil fuels, which means that the world continues to heat up. So all the bad climate change stuff will continue to get worse. And that's what I mean when I say doom. Think about Florida, the flattest state in the country, with over 1,300 miles of coastline and over 3/4 of its residents living along the coast. Rising sea level means that most of the state is at risk for big time flooding. And think about all those glorious beaches, ruined. So it's clear that the Earth is heating up. There's no debate about that. What's not so clear is exactly how hot things are going to get. Climate science is really complex and difficult to make predictions, and scientists don't have a crystal ball.
We don't know when we're gonna hit those disastrous thresholds, but we know that every bit of more warming makes them more likely. So you're loading the dice against yourself.
That's where the IPCC comes in. The IPCC is a part of the United Nations, and it stands for the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. It's been the world's top authority on climate science for the last 30 years. Thousands of climate scientists from around the world volunteer their time to analyze and summarize the latest and best climate science. The result is big, fat reports that are the best around when it comes to predicting the future of climate change. So what do these big, fat reports say? Well, strap in for a giant dose of doom, folks. If we keep burning fossil fuels like we are today, then we're blowing past 1.5 degrees of warming by 2100. We'll almost definitely hit 2 degrees, and we might even reach 3 or even 4 degrees. That means longer and more intense heat waves and stronger hurricanes and dangerous flooding. In fact, since 2008, an average of 24 million people have been displaced by catastrophic weather disasters each year. As climate change worsens, scientists and migration experts expect that number to rise.
Doesn't mean we won't survive as a species or something, but it means that we are in for a huge amount of climate change. And every day we delay makes it easier to be a pessimist.
To get a handle on climate change, most experts agree that we need to make drastic changes to the way that we live. Just recycling and using energy-efficient light bulbs ain't gonna cut it. I'm talking big, system-wide changes to get off fossil fuels, like carbon taxes on businesses and phasing out gas vehicles. But to do this, we need politicians to agree on stuff and pass laws. And I don't know if you've been paying attention to politics recently, but our representatives in Washington can't even agree on what day of the week it is. The status quo is the status quo for a reason. It's just easier to keep doing things the way we've always been doing them. All right, so things don't look so great. After hearing all this, you might want to go sit in a dark room with a pint of ice cream and eat away your feelings. Ice cream is a great way to deal with doom. But here's the good news. We know what we need to do. Let's take a quick look at the three big areas where shifting away from fossil fuels would slow down the warming of the planet. Let's start with transportation. 95% of the vehicles on the planet burn fossil fuels. They're responsible for almost one-third of all greenhouse gas emissions worldwide. It might seem like a pipe dream to replace all those gas guzzlers with electric vehicles, but it might not be.
In the last decade and a half, electric vehicles that don't have any pollution out of the tailpipe went from a dream to commonplace in places like California, China, Norway.
Then we have the energy sector. Think power plants. In 2016, 80% of the world's energy came from fossil fuels, while only 5% came from renewables like solar and wind. But we're seeing that change.
Now solar is the cheapest form of energy in just two decades. That's a huge change. And now we have rooftop solar across most of California. We have large solar systems in desert and sunny areas. And so we've seen technologies go from attractive but not affordable to everyday.
In fact, in the US, renewable energy has doubled over the last 10 years. And finally, we need to talk about how we're using land, people. Basically, we're cutting down way too many trees and using a lot of that land to raise livestock that we end up eating. Now, I don't want to tell anyone how to eat. I mean, I just had two steak tacos. But the United Nations estimates that if the world stopped getting food from animal sources, greenhouse gas emissions could be cut by one-fourth.
We've already seen what 5 years ago people thought was going to be a real battle to get our meat-dependent diet start to shift. We're already seeing young people around the planet shifting significantly, whether they go vegetarian or vegan or just reduce the number of days they eat meat.
Still feel like we're doomed? Well, even if we can't stop global warming at 1.5 degrees, it's not the end of the world. Literally. The world won't suddenly end if it gets 2 or 3 or even 4 degrees warmer. But we will have to adapt the way we live to function in a hotter world. So what does adapting to climate change look like? It's building seawalls and more wetlands to protect coastal cities from flooding, planting different varieties of crops that can handle hotter temperatures, thinning fire-prone forests, and requiring tough new building codes. It might even mean living in different places. Take Indonesia, for example. Their coastal capital, Jakarta, is sinking, and experts predict that by 2050, almost the entire city could be underwater. So they're considering moving the whole city to avoid massive flooding. Now, it's not an easy task to relocate 10 million people, but hey, it beats drowning. But of course, adaptation costs money, which means less developed nations will have a harder time adapting. Those countries will most likely suffer the most. So, what's your mindset when it comes to climate change? Are you an optimist or a pessimist? Let us know why in the comments below. And if you want to learn more about climate change policies, check out our video all about the carbon tax debate. And we've got a whole other video that deals with extreme weather. And for all you teachers out there, get your students talking about this on our website, KQED Learn. And as always, I'm your host, Myles Bess. Peace out.